Hello and welcome to Story to Satori. Today we have a very interesting guest from Visakhapatnam, but I believe she's not in Visakhapatnam right now, and I can hear some birds chirping in the background. So her name is Nidhi Chauhan, and let me quickly introduce her to you. She is a multitasker, in fact, multi-talented person who is a CV designer, an interview coach, and soft skills trainer, and as well as content writer and motivational speaker. This is what I see on her LinkedIn profile. And I have been actually interacting with her since a long time on LinkedIn, and that's how we got connected. And I found her very interesting because she's very young, basically. And so welcome to Story to Satori, Nidhi.
Thank you so much. I'm humbled by your introduction. I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing good. I'm staying safe. I'm staying at home. And we have all are facing the same problem, coronavirus. So how is it? Can you just tell me where you are right now? Are you with your family? And where are you right now?
I am not with my family. I'm all by myself. I'm in Andhra Pradesh. Mm-hmm. So because the extensive measures that were taken to control it, before the shutdown of the airspace, I couldn't make it back home. So I'm here, I'm at peace, and I'm at peace.
Oh my God. So you're not in your hometown, neither are you in your base camp, that is Visakhapatnam, but you're in some other place, kind of, you know. So how long will this be? We never know, right? So where are you in a, you are in a hostel or someplace nice and safe?
Yes, I'm in a ladies hostel. So it's all nice and safe here. I hope it's good at your end too.
Yes, yes, absolutely. Taking care and enjoying that peace after a long time. There's like no noise of the traffic, and instead we can hear the birds chirping. So yes. Welcome again. And so usually, you know, you are, as I said, a CV designer and an interview coach. You, at a young age, you have, I have actually researched about you and found that you were a very good student in school and college. You were a topper. Yes. And then you got into, you know, from an IT background, you switched over to HR. And then you started finding your niche again in helping people, especially youngsters, I believe, getting jobs and helping them with the designing of CVs, in helping them with interviewing questions, and also being a speaker. You like to speak. You speak on podiums, as well as you do a lot of soft skills training. Mm-hmm. So tell me, I would ask you a question. What's the next step in the interview hiring process right now in this condition when we are facing such uncertainties, like mm-hmm. how the typical question as an interviewer, what is mm-hmm. the next step in the interviewing and hiring process now in this situation? What do you see?
In this situation right now, it's going to be remote hiring. First of all, people are so scared, they will not step out of their homes so quickly in order to seek a job. Because even in walk-in interviews, you see close to 200, 250 odd people. And in that sort of a setting, it is going to be, again, risky for the company. Because if there's just one person with the disease, then they have to shut down their entire office. But it's also important to keep in mind that there's such economic slowdown that right now, as soon as the situation is resolved, which we are hoping would be soon, every company would be back on track. And as a part of the measures that the companies have taken, some of them have laid off candidates already. They have certain vacancies that already had to be filled, combined with these vacancies that are created because people have been laid off. And now they would need a greater workforce at a little lesser salary so that they could recuperate and come back on track. So remote hiring, number one, would be the thing. And number two would be extensive hiring. They will be looking for people who can stand out of the crowd and they can do their work. The number one quality should be adaptability in this case.
Right. So very well said. And so a lot of people who are on looking for jobs and not having jobs and who have become very depressed in a situation like this. So they need to know from what you are saying is, one is, you know, stand out from the crowd, and also understand that they are not going to get paid as much as they were, you know, expecting before this. And everything is going to change. There's a lot of things that are going to change in a way that the industry is fashion. I mean, they're going to figure out, you know, how they're going to hire as well as how much they're going to hire. So is it a kind of positive, you know, it can't be a positive, but then as a recruiter and as a person who helps people with getting jobs, how are you feeling, you know, how's your own, this kind of, how are you, now you're stuck in this situation where you're neither with your family nor with your, in your place where you were working from, that's Visakhapatnam. You are in some place where you have gone for a travel for a assignment. And then you're stuck there. You do not know. How are you feeling, you know? What kind of feelings you are going through? Must be pretty tough.
It was initially, to be very honest. I was a little disturbed because my mother was very emotional that I couldn't come home. So initially, I was a little scared because positive cases had come up in like 12-kilometer radius from my home. And then I realized there's no point fretting over it because it's beyond my control. And I just let it be. I started doing my thing and started researching on different things. I've been learning different things. I've been completing certification courses, enjoying with the people around me. And there are many people, in fact, who've been getting in touch with me who have been unemployed for the last couple of years. And now they are in such slumps because they think if they were expecting 20,000, they can expect 8,000 to 10,000 now. So I've also been spending my time guiding these people and how they should be going ahead right now.
So you are looking at the positive side of things, and then, as you rightly said, this is a space or a time probably where you have more opportunities to help people who are going through, and then you have the talent yourself too. You're always a motivated person, being a motivational speaker. Now, one of the things that you have kind of written about is the snakes and ladders, right?
Yes.
And it's like I mean, the article was really very eye-opening, you know. So can you talk about that? You know, what made you to write this kind of an article and snakes and ladders? Have you have you ever played that game, you know, of snakes and ladders? And now, is it something resonating with what you had written quite a while ago? And now, like everything was going fine. We were all on top of our game and having a great time. And suddenly we see ourselves in the kind of dumps, you know, like bitten by the snake and fallen down on earth. So what, can you just throw some light on that article you written?
Sure. So this, I think, was a post that I wrote close to 3 months ago. And this is something I pulled out from my journal that I wrote back in 8th standard. I still remember as a family, we would sit down, play Ludo together. And sometimes, you know, we kids like to throw tantrums. So I would say, I'm not going to roll the dice now, you know, because every time I go, there's a snake that's pulling me down. And I remember my father giving me that bit of wisdom then. That my child, there are snakes, but there are ladders too. The only way you go ahead in the game and actually make it to the 100 is by rolling the dice. And in this scenario right now, we were all, you know, on that ladder that takes you to 98 or something, pretty close to 100. And then we thought we're just going to make it. Everybody was so close to their goals. We were like New Year resolutions, we'll smash it and stuff. And then suddenly there was this snake that took us all the way down. Right now, it resonates so deeply because I know in my heart that the only way to go ahead is by rolling the dice. Simple. You can't keep crying over spilt milk. You can't keep trying to control what is not under your control. It is so much that is natural. It's so much of an outer thing. If you can control what is going on inside, keep rolling the dice, as I've said in the article, and moving forward, you will again reach exactly where you were. It can take longer, but the good news is you will reach there.
So there is good news always, you know, after the, there is always light after the darkness, right?
Yes, a rainbow and, after the storm.
A rainbow after the storm. And in every adversity, there is always some hidden miracle that might happen at any point. But then you need to act. You need to throw the dice, as you rightly said. That's very important. Very, I think, wisdom nuggets from your father. And I remember, you know, in some of your writing, you wrote a lot about your father who was actually into the Navy and in Indian Navy, and how he had gone into the submarine. And for many days, he was, you know, like fighting like a warrior in that submarine, you know, We can't imagine now. We are like, you know, at, in the home with every amenity still there, with the television, with the internet, with so much, all the gadgets, and we feeling claustrophobic. And how your father would have felt, you know, having gone a lot of, you know, feet down deep below the sea, and then it would have been. So can you just throw light on your childhood, you know, tell us something about your childhood. You're still young, of course, you know, you're just 22, I believe, 22
24.
Or something, 24, and that's really awesome, you know, you are doing such wonderful work at such a young age. And you have actually, you know, around more than 7,000 people, you have helped them with their CVs and with their designing their careers. In fact, I wouldn't say CVs, it's designing their careers. A lot of us get, a lot of youngsters, millennials, and you are in, from the, you know, what is it called? You're from the generation Z, Z generation, Gen Z. So you're a Gen Z's. So y'all are having that attitude about always, you know, kind of taking it easy. How was your attitude? You know, can you try throw some light on your stories? Tell some stories about your childhood and how you're right now.
So the childhood of a person very intimately shapes how they become as an adult. And that is a proven fact in psychology. So growing up, as you rightly pointed out, my father was a submariner and he had to go for his sailing. So once you're inside the submarine and the submarine takes a dive, that's all. There's no external communication. I would not know where my father is. He would tell us at times that he'd be back in 21 days. Sometimes it would be operations where they would not be allowed to tell their families and what time they'd be back. So I did see my mother waiting for any and every update that there could be. And my mother used to take care of us while he was away. However, there's this beautiful parenting that I saw from therein that I was never really missing my father, because my mother used to make sure, even though we could not communicate with him, that she made us feel that he's okay and he's going to be back soon. Then growing up, I was the odd one out in my class. I was always that child in the corner with those big spectacles, which I still have. Sitting in the corner, you know, not really interacting much and wondering about so many things that were happening around me. I would ask out-of-the-box questions. Sometimes I would shut out by, I was shut out by teachers. Sometimes they encouraged me, and one of those teachers encouraged me to make best friends with a diary and pour out every thought there was, because I was always told I was too mature for my age. And I started writing. So that shaped the writing part. Then since my childhood, I have not known stage fear, touch wood. So the first time I was asked to make a speech, my father gave me 5 books. I thought he would write the speech and give it to me. I was a second standard baby. But he gave me 5 books. He said, there's something called the index. Look up. You have to develop your own style of speaking. Okay. Back then, I was very pissed off with him. But today, I'm so grateful, because every time he sent me to the library to research on my speeches, he equipped me with a very strong tool very early on in life. And honestly speaking, at this point of time, when I see the entire world cribbing and saying, it's been 7 days, we have nothing to do, we have finished YouTube, Netflix, everything, the respect for my father actually grows so much, because there's barely any space to move around in the submarine. My father is a tall man. He can't even stand completely straight in a submarine. There are so many men packed, not one extra man on a submarine. You can hear machinery all around you. There's again the hierarchy to be followed. You can't be sitting and whiling away your time, because even if one person loses out on their focus, the entire submarine can be doomed. And that means that even your dead bodies don't go back to your family. You just lie at the bottom of the ocean. So there was 24/7 mental alertness needed. There was such little space. And I believe that is what has taught my father the gratitude of everything that there is in life. And in a way, I would say the world is starting to learn that gratitude and appreciate everything while staying indoors. And now, because of the situation that there is, I can hear people who have never spoken to their neighbors just shouting out and asking if they're okay, if they need something. So that is how it's been. Apart from that, growing up, I was a good student. But my father always told me, and this is something I've followed, getting a job is very different from getting a career. And getting a career is very different from finding your calling. The three never have to be the same. So you can be in a job and not be happy. You can be building a career that is not your calling. So my focus was always on finding my calling, and that's how my childhood shaped me.
Wow. So that's an awesome story, you know, I could hear from you as to how you had these great values instilled in you right from your younger age. And that story about the submarine, I think, yeah, you could write. You are a great writer as well. I mean, I keep reading
Thank you.
all your content, and there's so much of poetry as well. You know, there's a deep thought gone before you write something. And so tell me, you know, when was the first time that you wrote? You started speaking at a young age, as
Yes.
you said. And when was it that you started writing?
I was 7.
Oh, and what was that motivated you to write at that young age?
That young age, I used to go to the library. So weekends, all the kids used to go to the park to play. I used to go to the library to read some story. And also journaling was instilled when I was 7. So I was given my own notebook and I was told, whatever you learn from reading a story, write it down. Write down how your day was. So I always had a companion in terms of a journal that way. That's when I started writing. And the motivation was a story that I read about the fox and the grapes. So that was nice. That was the first time I wrote that it's bad to criticize. Of course, easy to write, hard to do. It took me years to implement that, but it was nice.
Good, good. And so are you a serious person, or you, because you always kept to yourself, read, went to the library instead of the park, and then went into writing, speaking at young age. So are you now a serious person, or are you a fun-loving person?
I am an ambivert, so people who know me will know that I am like the craziest person around. I can crack the lamest of jokes and laugh all by myself. But the ones who associate with me professionally barely get a hint of that. So there are, I wouldn't say that's a switch of personality as such. I would say there are two different parts of my personality. So when I work, I'm working. When I'm having fun, I'm having full-on fun. So I would say a balanced personality that way.
Wonderful. And has it really helped you now, you know? Another question I wanted to ask you was, you switched over from the IT industry into the HR very quickly, you know, after having felt not really fitting into that industry. And then you wanted to be more creative, more into people person instead of the, you know, the machine person. So at this point, many, I think, you know, this one is there's more opportunity for you now to work from home because this doesn't require you. And even when the technical jobs are becoming more home-based, now many are really struggling to make this decision. You know, even I am a mentor for women, especially who are in the middle age. You know, when they get married and have a kid, and suddenly after 8 years of career, you know, they feel they can't find the balance between the work and the home, looking after the kid, and their heart is towards one thing, and the mind is telling go earn, and you know. And of course, now the situation is very different. But, you know, I keep mentoring. In fact, just last fortnight, there was a kind of an expert chat that I did. The reason why I'm saying this is you are helping young people, you know. So do you come across these cases similar to yours where people have really not thought about it before they have decided? Forget about the calling, you know. Let's talk about the passion, you know. Many a times calling is something which I would say the highest, where people need to be really aligned to their purpose to find their calling, you know, which happens.
Very true.
And you're lucky. You're one of the lucky ones. It took me a long time, you know. It took me a long time to find my calling because it was my choice, you know. I knew I could find it, but then I took time because I was having a lot of self-doubt and those things, you know. I don't want to go into my story, but then, of course, this whole program is called Story to Satori. So going away from stories of doubt, judgment, and negative self-beliefs towards that Satori, which is a space of, it's not may not necessarily be spiritual enlightenment, but getting the wisdom, standing in the light and power of your own self. So are there, you know, are there people who come to you and you help them out to find that kind of a space where people are getting confused, you know, especially in these lot of changes that are happening. And now we are facing ourselves in such a dilemma. So do you help people with changing, switching careers, thinking, you know, different directions and getting new perspectives?
Yes, I do that. And I do that for freshers and experienced people alike. So just last fortnight, there was a person with 14 odd years of experience who was so unhappy with his work. And he said that this whole virus situation has opened his eyes to the fact that he can die any moment. And he doesn't want to live that way. He wants to switch. Similarly, there are many people, and the problem basically with our country is that we don't want to weigh any proper choices. We want to weigh the popular choices. And there's a lot of difference between the two. So engineer, doctor is what we look at. But if a child says, I want to be a fashion designer, the child is looked at as though the child is abnormal. So I do help people with respect to their career counseling, and I make sure that I involve the family wherever necessary, because these are collective decisions that are taken. So there are detailed analysis that I do. There's a SWOT analysis that I do. I help them understand their own strengths and weaknesses. I help them understand the difference there is between a hobby and a job. So you cannot always make a career out of your hobby itself, because sometimes you're not yet at that stage. And I use the word yet because you can be at that stage. So sometimes you're not yet at that stage, and time needs to be taken. So I mentor people for the same. So that's how I help them.
That's really very well said. You know, the last thing that you said was, differentiating between the hobby and the passion, because many times people get confused about these two things, you know, and they get mixed up, and your hobby cannot be your passion.
It's all the time, kind not of all the time.
You pick up.
It can
not all
be.
The time. Yeah, it Correct. Can be. But as you said, you know, we need to do a little deep diving and find out whether that is really our passion. So on a closing note, you know, wanted to keep this a little short and make this more power-packed, and I really enjoyed talking to you. So what is the message that you, what is the message that you want to give out to people of your age, maybe millennials, and then more middle-aged people, maybe even seniors, whoever is watching and listening to this podcast as well as this show? What is it that they need to do in these changing, uncertain times, especially in regard to careers, you know, because you are a career expert. And so what do they need to do? How do they know? Do they need to hone skills, or do they just need to go find out what their hobby is and what their passion is, find out the difference, or what exactly they need to do now? How do they tackle the situation?
So my message to anybody who's listening, irrespective of their age group, would be, number one, go with your priority. If you do not have that kind of background where you can follow anything blindly without having to worry about the financial support, well and good. Most of us don't come from that place as such. Number one, take care of your priority. That is, do you have food on your table? Do you have a roof over your head? For that, you need to do two things. Have a good amount of soft skills that the industry is looking at. And number two, have a good amount of relevant hard skills related to your job. For example, if you're required to learn any coding languages for your job, or you're required to know something else, do that. Make sure you have certifications for that if you were not taught that in college, irrespective of what age you are from. There are several platforms outside, outstanding ones. There's HubSpot, there's Udemy, there's edX, there's LinkedIn Learning. So just learn and make sure that it is quantified in terms of something, and it's not you speaking in thin air. Once your financial thing is taken care of, number two, deep dive into getting yourself skilled in what it is that you want to do with your life. If you know that, well and good. If you do not know that, try different things and find out. And if you know that, make sure you take your skills a notch higher. You cannot be starting off as a newbie in something and trying to be competing against an ace professional person, say from a place like Nat Geo, if you're looking at photography. So you have to learn whatever is necessary for what you love. And once you keep doing that, and this is not once in a blue moon thing, once you keep doing that, start with a source of passive income. Your full-time job alone should not be your source of income. And this is the biggest lesson that the world is carried from this epidemic right now, that a single source of income will never help you. Even for 21 days, that's not sufficient. So create a passive source of income as you start honing your skills. Put yourself out on platforms like LinkedIn, where there are people who are professionals. Absolutely. Engage with people. Tell people that you know something, because there is no point in being a lamp under a basket. You'd rather be a city on the top of a hill for people to see. As you keep doing that, you will face struggles. You'll face a lot of struggles. There'll be times you can't balance your personal life with professional life. Maybe your child will fall sick. Maybe you will fall sick. Life will keep throwing curveballs at you. But as we discussed, remember, just roll the dice and keep going. Never sit down in one place. As long as you keep rolling the dice and keep going, everything is going to be fine in its own time.
Awesome. I think wonderful wisdom nuggets which need to be revisited and listened to this maybe twice. That's why we made it short and power-packed, because these messages which are coming from a youngster, I mean, person who's just 24 years old and but so wise, you cannot just do with one income. You can't just think about only active income. These are the days when we need to have passive income. And then think about if it is photography, as you really said, just don't, you know, think about the basics. You need to go dive deeper, become an expert in that. It takes some time, have patience, but then always keep hustling. Don't just say that, you know, what I have as a job is going to be there for eternity. Things change. True. But nevertheless, there's always a brighter side of any picture. So always try to be positive and take the tips which Didi Chauhan, our career expert here, and she can help you with that. We both are on LinkedIn. So reach out to her. I can share all the links below our the videos that I'm going to share. So just reach out to Nidhi Chauhan, and you can also reach out to me. So we help people to redesign their lives, and especially in redesigning their careers and thinking out of the box, thinking about different careers, in fact. So thank you so much, Nidhi. And I think even I could get a lot of things to learn from you, especially the attitude part. You know, you are doing what, you know, it would take another couple of decades for people to learn. And you guys are really, you know, rocking it. You're killing it, being youngsters, and really nice to have you on the show. Like to have you Thank more you. On the show, but this time, we just want to make it short and a lot of power-packed things. Thank you very much.
Thank you so
stay
much.
Safe. It's been a pleasure. Stay safe and stay at home. Thank you. Thank you for being on.
The you show. Too.
Thank bye you. Bye. Bye.